Hello and welcome. My guest today is Dr. Javaid Sheikh, the Dean of Weill Cornell Medical College in Qatar. Dr. Sheikh is an internationally renowned researcher. He has taught at Stanford University School of Medicine, and he has also served as chairman of the board of Palo Alto Institute for Research and Education in California. Dr. Sheikh, it's great to have you here.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Dr. Sheikh, you have a remarkable background in psychiatry and behavioral sciences. So I wanted to ask you a question that's on most people's minds today. What is the science of happiness?
Sheikh, you begin with a very simple question, don't you? Well, I think it may be helpful if we step back and try to define this concept of happiness. I mean, you know, this is a very subjective and elusive concept. So some people might mean this means satisfaction. Another person might think this means contentment. Another one might think this is joy. And then, of course, to the extreme of rapture and pleasure. So I think those, we need to be careful that a lot of those concepts can sometimes be encapsulated by this large concept of happiness. So it's hard to focus on the science of happiness without defining the term. So, but if we take them concept by concept, there has been a lot of work in the last 10, 15 years on the neural structures and underlying chemistry of happiness and the psychology of it. Human beings are marvelously well adapted to dealing with all kinds of losses and stresses and coming back to a point where they feel reasonably well contented and happy. An example would be if you look at lottery winners who are very happy, so to speak, you know, a few hours or few weeks after winning lottery, and compare that with people who have been in accidents, for example, or even to the point of being paraplegic, who are obviously devastated a few hours or few weeks after that. But if you look at the same people in a year or two afterwards, there actually is not much difference from their baseline before the accident or before winning lottery. So that's a very good example of what humans can do in terms of adapting to either highs or lows, but bringing it back to a normal kind of state of affairs. I think we are not to the point where I can identify very clear neural structures, because as I said earlier, there are multiple concepts which form the basis of this overall concept of happiness. But the good news is that we are getting there.
Now, what can you tell us about the perception of stress? If everybody has their own perception about reality, are people actually stressed, or are they creating their own stress?
Yeah, that's a very good question again. They are feeling stressed when they feel stressed, no question about it. Now, it is true that one person's stress might be just a challenge to another person, or a little activation and enthusiasm for another person. So that is true. However, having said that, I think there are certain circumstances which can produce stress in most human beings. For example, commuting for long distances on a daily basis. I mean, that can lead to chronic stress because it's beyond the initial enthusiasm at that point. You're kind of feeling stuck. One of the key concepts that scientists who have looked into the concept of stress have found is that if people feel out of control, if they feel like they have no control over their circumstances, that is when the excitement and enthusiasm gets converted into a feeling of stress. And even though human body, whole physiology is really marvelously suited to adapting to stressful circumstances, usually in the short run, over a period of time, weeks, months, and years, if that continues, that is what we call chronic stress, and that impacts physiology and impacts health. No question about that. Yeah.
What is your opinion on mind over matter? Can we change the chemistry of our brain by changing our thoughts?
Very good question again. Yes, my opinion is that we can definitely change the chemistry and change our actions and behavior. In my own area of research, looking at anxiety disorders and stress-related disorders, I mean, that's over the last two decades or so, study after study has investigated and looked at this issue very carefully. And what we have found is that you can do imaging studies before and after treatment, particularly after what we call cognitive behavior treatment. Cognitive behavior treatment typically is restructuring of thoughts and changing feelings and changing behavior. And groups of people who have multiple anxiety disorders, that could be post-traumatic stress disorder or panic attacks or chronic anxiety disorder or obsessive compulsive disorder, almost all of those disorders before treatment and after cognitive behavior therapy, you see a distinct difference in chemistry and neural structures, which tells you that you can change neurochemistry, you can change, mind can change body, and it is mind over matter, no question about it.
Now, Dr. Sheikh, as the dean of the college, what advice would you give to students and graduates about the significance of inner peace?
Being just a dean and not a guru, I will focus on maybe the values and satisfaction that people can strive toward. Inner peace, I don't know, but let's just focus on a deep sense of satisfaction and contentment. And mercifully, and I would say fortunately, our students are in a profession which really is, to my mind, the noblest of professions. When you set up your long-term objectives toward taking care of other people, toward taking care of sick patients, that is a very satisfying experience. And I can say with full conviction that most of our students will achieve that kind of deep satisfaction which leads to inner peace.
Well, Dr. Sheikh, I think we've learned some great things here today. It's really been great talking to you.
Thank you. Same here.
Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this edition, and we'll see you next time.